Welcome to Davos, Katy. We are so happy to have you. How are you doing?
I'm great. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Why don't we start and jump straight in our future of work conversation? And maybe why don't you start by introducing yourself?
Sure. My name is Katy George. I'm a senior partner in McKinsey's New Jersey office, and I am our global chief people officer.
Well, very welcome to have you. And there is a lot of topics that we discuss in the prep that I am very excited to just go around. Maybe the first topic is around the role of the chief people officer. There's been a lot of transformation in the recent years. We see the chief people officer going up the ranks of the C-level, and also a lot of topics around the talent being one of the top worry of the CEOs. So why don't you tell us about your view of how the role is evolving?
Well, one of the things our clients tell us is that talent is now top three topic, literally on every CEO's mind, and therefore a top topic of every C-suite. You know, at McKinsey & Company, we've always had what we call a two-part mission. So we've always had a mission around client and a mission on people. So it's always been integral and very, very strategic. But it's been interesting. I do think that if you look at, and COVID has accelerated this, some of the trends, we see much faster digitization of every work process at every company, including management consulting, you know, the use of big data and advanced analytics. And you also see changes in workforce expectations, which pre-COVID we would have all said was generational, and post-COVID we'd say expands to many, many segments of our workplace. And so I think that this means that the role of the chief people officer or CHRO is increasingly strategic. The notion of how do you create talent strategies that are dynamic to accommodate the rapid shifts and the volatility we see in what companies need to do and how they need to do it is a real strategic skill, and it's quite different from kind of, you know, what HR sometimes is seen in the old days as kind of policy and compliance. At McKinsey, I kind of think of our role around three big things. One is, how do we make sure that we have the right support and expertise to counsel our leaders, the leaders who lead our geographies, the leaders who lead our practices, whether they're functional practices or sector practices, with a really holistic approach to talent strategy. Where should we recruit from? What capabilities do we need? Where are we going to recruit senior people versus people right out of school? How do we think about our learning and development programs to develop skills? How do we think about our people architecture? So you think about all the different levers, workforce development, increasingly important in our industry and in other industries. So all of that kind of strategy needs to come together in a way that is not just business responsive, but frankly, business leading, because we need to be looking out ahead. Secondly, how do we compose and help teams be incredibly effective, but also apprenticing our colleagues and creating a great work-life balance and a great experience for our individual colleagues? So we do a lot of work in thinking about how do you put the right groups of people together so we have all the right expertise, whether that's global talent sources or local, and then how do we actually help them work with the rituals that allow them to be very successful, and how do we measure that along the way to intervene when we need to? And then the third role that we, of course, have is really providing individual counsel. McKinsey, of course, traditionally has been a place where most of our colleagues develop their careers not with a line manager, but as a result of being deployed to different projects. It truly is what, you know, now many companies are going to in terms of an agile talent development system. And so that's always been what we do, but it means that we need to provide really good counseling to our individual colleagues to help them on that journey. And we're increasingly orienting our whole talent architecture to self-authored skill journeys, which means we need to help people understand how to access the learning and development and apprenticeship opportunities that they need, and help them think through how they meet their own professional goals using our using McKinsey as a platform.
That's a very comprehensive role. And I'm sure it keeps you quite busy. You touch on a topic I would like to hear more about. You said big data. Mm-hmm. How is big data transforming the way that you practice your role as a chief people officer today. You talked about skills, supporting how you build teams, etc. Can you elaborate on that topic?
Yeah, I mean, it's fascinating because, you know, we of course are, like every company, recruiting a lot more tech talent and want to become great at helping tech talent develop, but also integrating so that everybody, in a sense, is a technologist at some level. But it's also been really fun to really lean into, we have a fantastic people analytics team, and to lean into our advanced analytics capability and increasingly think about data architecture and digital work enablement in order to drive outcomes for our organization internally as well. And so I actually think this is, we call it teamwork as a science. So how do we pair up the kind of rituals that we know work effectively to drive great outcomes for our people, for our teams, for our clients, pair that up with analytics so that we are on an ongoing basis learning. So for example, we have 4,000 teams around the world. We are increasingly now able to say, what choices are they making about hybrid, as an example? You know, who's co-locating together with their teams? Who's co-locating with their clients? Are they doing it at the beginning of a project, in the middle, at the end? Are they doing it in a uniform way? Are they making different tailored choices? How are they using technology? And we're able to see how those choices are now in the data, not just perception, but in the data driving outcomes. Increasingly, we'll be able to see outcomes around apprenticeship and skill acquisition. We'll be able to see a whole set of outcomes from a client perspective. Now we can measure satisfaction and kind of client feedback. But now we're already able to see the connection to retention, for example. So, you know, gone are the days when you do a big engagement survey once a year, and then you do all sorts of analysis with all sorts of kind of segmentation to say, what did we learn last year? Which usually those learnings are available, you know, months later, and then you're kind of trying to look ahead. Increasingly, we're able to see real time how are people feeling, how successful are the different teams, and where can we make effective interventions to help them, whether it's with mental health or whether it's with team scoping or anything in between.
In our most recent research, The Future of Work, we actually highlighted one of the things you were talking about around retention.
Yes.
That one of the big dependency is not so much on salary. That's the usual thing that is thrown at your face. You need to pay me more. But actually, well-being was one of the topic. And more importantly, career development and skills. So what's your view on retention? You talk also about hybrid. What are the factors that are really playing a great role on retention?
So both our research and our internal experience confirms exactly what you said, that compensation is ticket to play, and it might, you know, but it is absolutely not the key to retention alone. And I would just add one other, neither are perks. So, you know, let's have, you know, really fabulous yoga class. That is not what's driving people's perception of well-being, nor is it what's driving kind of loyalty to an employer. So, what we're seeing in our research is exactly, and internally is exactly what you say, is that three things that I think matter to people. One is flexibility and work-life balance. I'll put those together. Secondly is a sense of purpose. And people no longer feel they need to identify with kind of one institution's purpose. They may have an individual purpose, whether it's well articulated or not, but they know if they feel like they're doing something that's valuable, that fits with their values. And they're willing to be much more flexible about finding ways, you know, in and out of companies to achieve that, as well as the work-life balance. And the third is exactly what you said, which is absolutely essential, whether it's a frontline operations person or, you know, a high-end knowledge worker, career development, skill development is absolutely critical. You know, you asked before about where are we using advanced analytics, and that's the other place, having really great skill architecture in our people model, which increasingly we're seeing, you know, other companies do as well, and then being able to really help colleagues in their pathway to skill development in a way that is very dynamic and flexible, which meets, frankly, both their needs, but also ours. The world's changing too fast to go back in the back room in corporate headquarters in the HR, you know, team room and write up career paths. You need to actually allow career paths to develop in a very dynamic way, given the integration of technology, sustainability, all sorts of things into traditional domain skill and expertise areas.
Yeah, that's absolutely fantastic. And I totally agree with you. I think we are entering an era where we're talking about the personalization
yes.
of the career journey and not having like a one-size-fits-all. So totally.
And then there's so many different elements of that personalization, which, you know, so one of the pivots, if you will, that we've really made is this notion of self-authorship, which I've mentioned and tied to skills. You know, and it used to be when your review was coming up, we would send you a memo on what we value, and we'd say, tell us how you're doing. We now ask you instead to write your own leadership growth plan. What kind of professional are you trying to be? What impact in the world and in your client base are you trying to have? What are the skills that you've been working on, and what are the next skills? And of course, they fit patterns, right? The people who are focused primarily on being data scientists versus being CEO counselors, those, we understand those kind of patterns, those archetypes. But we no longer want to constrain anyone to live into some narrow kind of pathway that we've designed, because we found out, first of all, that our colleagues are much more creative than we are, and they were combining different things in lots of really exciting ways, and we want to reward and celebrate that.
And that leads me, because you were talking about this narrow path and how we escape that sensation of being the prisoner of our path. I was telling you that I met students recently, actually it was MBA students about to graduate, and they were very worried, am I choosing the right major? And
yeah.
And I don't know what you think about it, but I was like, I don't think it matters anymore. What do you think?
It's so interesting. One of the conversations I had today was with a university president from Singapore leading. And, you know, we talk about how we need people who are good at being interdisciplinary. And we need people who are good at understanding digital and analytics enough to at least be a good integrator, if not translator, if not practitioner. And that doesn't matter if you graduate with an art history degree or whether you graduate with a computer science degree. So increasingly, we're thinking about our sourcing strategy, our assessment strategy, to really focus on your ability to, certainly we want great problem solver, but we don't necessarily need you to be a great problem solver on a McKinsey business, you know, case study. We want you to demonstrate problem solving, you know, in whatever way makes sense. And we want you to be an integrator, and we want you to be digitally fluent. And so, and we want you to be a lifelong learner, someone who is curious, resilient, and will continue to develop skills over the course of your entire career, because that's essential, not just for McKinsey, but really any professional.
And in your experience, because I know you have a long track record in McKinsey as well, and you've done fantastic work with the manufacturing industry, how do you correlate the appetite from companies to reinvest on skills to success? Can you talk about some examples?
There is a whole cultural change around one of the things we talk about at McKinsey is everyone a learner and everyone a teacher every day, which is very different from the old people are the teachers and the young people are the learners, and it's a one-way flow. This is about all-way flows. And we see examples of this in our manufacturing work. With WEF, actually, have a partnership where we identify and celebrate the companies that have individual manufacturing sites or parts of supply chain that have really demonstrated impact with Fourth Industrial Revolution tools and capabilities. And we didn't start this from a skilling or workforce perspective. We're literally looking at what's your maturity level in using new digital manufacturing capabilities and techniques and use cases, and what's the demonstrated financial impact of that? If you don't have demonstrated financial impact, we're not that interested. And guess what all of them have in common? Huge investment in frontline workforce skill building. Huge investment and workforce engagement. This is not about computers and automation taking over the workforce. This is about using technology to enable the workforce to do their job better, which I find, you know, as a people person, I find incredibly exciting and hopeful that the future is worker-centric. And that's true whether it's McKinsey and we're worrying about whether ChatGPT will synthesize all of our work for our clients instead of us, or whether we're talking about manufacturing, that technology is to make people, human beings, better and extend our capabilities.
Yeah, and I'm totally convinced we see that also with our clients, where the convergence of technology and the human factor is just expanding the ability of the human to have an impact on their work. So absolutely.
Yeah. But it does mean that individuals have to think of themselves as lifelong learners, and companies have to continue to invest in different ways to build skills, whether it's through apprenticeship. You know, one of the things that is the most challenging, I think, at least for us in hybrid, is that our apprenticeship was always in person and informal. And that was a critical way that we build skills. We have great learning programs also, but critical to have apprenticeship, on-the-job apprenticeship. And so we are now teaching how to apprentice others, because it used to just happen naturally. And now we need to be purposeful about showing people how we do work, even if we're, you know, online, if we're working in a virtual environment.
And I want to talk about the Great Resignation and all that happened post-pandemic. And I know, well, I guess McKinsey, just like any industries, have been impacted. So, and it links back to the retention topic we were having earlier. So where do you see this trend going? Do you see a slowdown? How do you see that from your vantage point?
For us, definitely, we're back to kind of pre-COVID attrition and retention rates, which is okay, but we'd actually like to get better. We'd actually like to learn from this experience to, you know, increase kind of the long-term value proposition to a larger pool of our talent. But I think we learned a lot, which is very much what we talked about before, that we need to give people more flexibility in how they build their careers. I think we've seen a permanent shift in workforce expectations, whether it's McKinsey or anywhere else, in terms of wanting a closer connection to purpose and wanting a closer connection to kind of an individualized kind of skill building, career development kind of path. And I think we have seen that people really believe and have seen that they can quit and find something else to do, that they can use the gig economy or the informal economy to build interesting parts of their career in a way that, you know, I think very few people were kind of understood, or a smaller segment understood before. I think certainly if we see a slowdown, we'll see some, you know, kind of balance of power shifts. But I think we see a permanent shift, and I think it's an exciting shift to live more into helping people be kind of whole people over the course of their lives.
One area where I would like to take your view is the women and the women leadership. We know that during the pandemic, they were just like the other minority, the most impacted. Yes. And they are also the category of workers the slowest to come back to the workforce. So how do you diagnose that, and what are your recommendations?
Agree, that is absolutely the trend we've seen in the data. And I do think it touches to the kind of flexibility and the importance of kind of whole life you know, support, if you will, that I was describing before, that, you know, as long as women have a disproportionate share of family responsibility, whether that's full-time, part-time, or whatever, we will continue to see a real challenge in that we have to equip all of our colleagues, all of our workforce, with the kind of flexibility that they need to actually deliver against all parts of their lives. You know, honestly, one of the things that I think is helpful is that increasingly young men also want more flexibility in being able to support and be part of their families' lives in a more present kind of full way. So I do think that we will continue to need to push not just on diversity programs and not just in kind of tracking and, you know, looking at pipelines and have we developed enough people to the next level. All of that's really important. It's on the ground kind of execution around really delivering against diversity goals. But I think, you know, what we need to do is at an underlying level is also ensure that we are creating the culture and the skill architecture. All of this helps if we move away from how many years of experience do you have, what degree do you have, to skills. All of this helps a much wider range of people, including women and other people who are diverse, to be successful.
Katy, thank you so much for your time and for sharing your passion. It's really infectious. I'm so happy to have you on our program today. And I wish you a great rest of your day. Thank you so very much.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure to be here.